I was racing my red tricycle around and around our small apartment in Greenville, Mississippi. It was 1950, and as I raced by my mother, she asked me to come and sit on her lap for a few minutes. I continued doing wheelies until I heard, "Martha Elise, I have something serious I want to talk to you about." I skidded to a stop and climbed up into her soft lap. She told me that she and my father, who was a compulsive gambler, hopeless alcoholic, and serial womanizer, were getting a divorce. Nothing would change in my sister's and my lives except that he would not be around anymore. The divorce was final in a couple of months. I was 6 years old. It didn't take long for me to realize the perks of being the daughter of a beautiful, raven-haired, brown-eyed, single mother. My mother's first boyfriend was a Cherokee crop duster from Oklahoma. I immediately began to imagine myself at some time in the future sitting by his side in the cockpit, flying low over the cotton crops in Mississippi, trying to ensure that those pesky bollwivels would never attack. Mama felt instantly in love. That Hank was in the process of getting divorced from his wife did not seem to be an impediment. They planned to marry until Mama discovered Hank was still in love with his wife, so they reluctantly said goodbye. Since we were poor, Mama had to get her first real job as a waitress at the local motel restaurant. She soon met Harry, who owned a car. Mama never learned to drive, and he took us on Sunday afternoon drives over the new bridge over the Mississippi River to Lake Village, Arkansas. The highlight of the afternoon was to stop at Stuckey's and buy a pecan roll. One day, however, Mama noticed Harry sitting at the table, teaching me how to forge a check. The check was reading $3, but he changed it to read $300. This incident evidently ended a possible but promising future career for me. By the time I was 7, I fell in love with one of those Christmas trends for little girls in the early 1950s. You remember them. It was a white, soft muff made of rabbit fur with matching white earmuffs. You know, the kind that were in White Christmas when Bing Crosby is singing the popular song of all times. I knew Mama could not afford to give those to me, so I really tried to believe that Santa would at least bring me that, or perhaps a cowboy outfit, complete with scabbard, pistol, leather-like vest, skirt, and cowboy hat. It was not until I was 12 and practically moving into adulthood that one of Mama's boyfriends made sure I had the much-longed-for hand muff and ear muff under the tree. There I sat, feeling very foolish on my grandmother's fold-out sofa, wearing my pajamas with my gigantic adolescent hands shoved into the new snow-white muff with earmuffs on while trying to smile for the camera. When I was 9, I found a 4-page letter that one of my mother's boyfriends, Granville, wrote to her from Stockton, California. Evidently, he was on the run from a former wife and was trying to keep his location a secret. He also struggled with an alcohol problem himself and promised Mama, "I never am going to drink any more whiskey again, and not many cocktails, for I know as well as you that no good will ever come from it, and it will really ruin you." While Mama never accepted his marriage proposal in the letter, and I never got any perks from Granville, he sounded like a nice guy when he signed his letter, "I beg to remain yours very truly." When I was 10, Mama decided to move into a larger apartment just around the corner. It was okay overall, but had a problem with both roaches and mice. My sister Judy and I were terrified. Then thankfully, Mama started dating a guy who worked for a pesticide company. I remember his coming in and spraying the kitchen and putting out some type of pellets that he said would take care of the mice. Mama said goodbye to him once we were rodent free. That summer, Mama decided she wanted to quit her job as a waitress and take us to the coast for the summer, but she couldn't quite figure out how to make it work. That is, until she met Mr. Levy. He was a nice Jewish man, but rather old for her. He loaned her $100 for the trip, nevertheless. I remember his trying to kiss her while going out the apartment door and her pushing him away. We had a great summer. Mama met Ronnie while she was working at the Holiday Inn, and he was laying carpets. They quickly became a couple. I remember eating red beans and rice, red beans and rice, red beans and rice for weeks that summer. And Ronnie was always there every day to eat with us, since his check from Holiday Inn had not come in yet. When the $90 check arrived, we all went to the grocery store. I remember yearning for some green grapes in the produce section and asking in an amazingly quiet voice, "Do you think I could buy some grapes?" I was told by Ronnie, "Honey, you can have anything in this store you want." I thought my food insecurity issues were finally over. Another one of my wishes during childhood was to take dancing lessons. I would even lie to my friends at Ella Darling Elementary School and say that I took lessons. Once I even humiliated myself by borrowing a children's size 12 tap shoes my friend Marilyn had outgrown, and I tried to do a tap dance in the talent show. I wore an adult size 2 at the time. Mama was still with Ronnie when we returned from the coast that year, and she told me he was going to pay, finally, for me to take dancing lessons. I could see myself in the future, dancing on my toes the way some of the girls in the talent show did. Unfortunately, the dance lessons ended when Ronnie's wife beckoned him to come home. When I was 11, I had my first ever birthday party at the Indian Mounds in Greenville, Mississippi. It was paid for by Mama's new boyfriend, Joe, who was in the Air Force at Keesler. He was some dozen or so years younger, but he seemed to love my sister and me just as much as he loved Mama. Hot dogs and Cokes have never tasted so good since that party. In addition to the perks given to me by my mother's boyfriends, I also learned some additional lessons and tolerance for others. For example, in our nearly all-white town, as I remembered mentioned earlier, Hank was a Cherokee, Mr. Levy was Jewish, and Doyle, a whole nother story entirely, was a paraplegic. While life always consists of multiple coming-of-age moments for us, one of the most important was learning to sacrifice these newly found perks. You see, Mama's latest boyfriend, Nelson, came to me when I was 16 and said he and Mama would be getting married in a few months. She had known him since high school, and they seemed to have the best of all reasons to marry. They were true friends. As for me, I soon learned that I did not need Mama's boyfriends and the perks anymore. I learned I could dance on my toes myself. There was one surprise, however, left. In 2004, when I was about to turn 60 years old, my stepfather Nelson died and left me with a surprise, $100,000 in his will.